Paperback Writer.
Okay. Oh, here we go. All right. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for saying good morning back. I was a little quiet there for a minute. Yeah. So welcome to worship. It is, oh, see, now I'm on. Thank you very much. Just took me a little while to warm up. So it is exciting with the next, today and the next three Sundays after, so the next four Sundays, including today, we are doing the Beatles. I am so excited about that, and I want to give huge thanks and kudos to all the music groups that suggested this. I don't know how long ago we talked about it, and all the work that you're putting into it. So thank you to all the music groups for doing that. The Foothills United Church is doing this as well, and in a different order, of course, and the children's choir is at Foothills today, singing Yellow Submarine. We'll get them on the 28th. They'll be here on the 28th. But they're at Foothills today, so it's wonderful. I'm going to send around the prayer basket, which I neglected to do last week. I don't know how many people knew that. I added it to prayers. But that's if you have a prayer for yourself or an event or anything, we can add it to the prayers of the people later on in the service. I should introduce myself for those of you that don't know me. My name's Tracy Robertson. Hi. I'm one of the ministers here at St. Thomas United Church, and Marion Martin is the halftime minister here, but she's also the halftime minister at Foothills. This is why we have a partnership with Foothills, because she's there on Sundays. So welcome to worship, those of you here in house and those of you at home. Please know that you are welcomed as well. We're going to start with our introit or gathering hymn, which is a partial of Hello, Goodbye. All the words are up on the screen. Let's join together in singing.
I say yes, I say no, you say strong.
We're going to do that every Sunday as our gathering hymn for the next four. So please join with me in our acknowledgement of the... I'm just going to use this one. Please acknowledge, or we acknowledge the Treaty 7 land that we live, work, and play on, and it, your part is in bold. It is responsive. So on this sacred ground, you are welcome. For thousands of years, we have been welcomed, Indigenous and non-Indigenous alike, in the traditional lands of the Blackfoot Confederacy, Treaty 7 territory, and the Métis homeland districts 5 and 6. Welcome to this place of retreat and refuge, worship and wonder. It is good to be here. And we at St. Thomas United Church are very proudly affirming, and so we say our affirming statement every Sunday as well. Again, it is responsive, and your part is in bold. We publicly, intentionally, and explicitly declare that St. Thomas United Church is an open and affirming congregation. We believe that all people are sacred in the eyes of God. We declare that we will continue our struggle to be open and affirming of all, regardless of age, ethnic, cultural or spiritual background, gender identity, sexual orientation, family composition, physical or mental capabilities, and economic circumstance. Let us all take a deep breath as we come with open hands, open hearts, and open minds, and we light the Christ candle. So Nancy's going to come forward. We light the Christ candle every Sunday as a physical reminder that God is with us in all times and all places and all spaces, and especially in those shadow times where we need a little bit more comfort and support. Amen. Oh, that's the end of me.
Okay. Morning, peace be with you. So please join me for the call to worship, and your part is in bold. In caring and compassion, God's arms hold us when we are weak. With ideas and inspiration, God pushes us to grow and thrive. With divine generosity, God shares all creation with us. God calls us as partners to build a world of love, joy, and hope where everything is shared equally. Let us join our hearts, our hands, and our voice with people the world over in praise, thanksgiving, and commitment to our wondrous God. And here's the opening prayer. Guide us, O God, amidst the rushing highways, the commercials, canyon, and the insistent crowds, walking with grim purpose to the workplace, shopping places, or even places of leisure. In the business of the day, teach us to notice the people on the margins, the patches of green hidden in the country, the laughter as well as the desperation, the places of healing and prayer, grant us the ability to open our eyes on all that is all around us, the joy of life with friends and strangers of all race and ability, and the caring that unlocks our fear and enables us to reach out to the world with love. We pray all these in your holy name. Amen.
Are you ready? All right, I'm going to invite all the young people to come forward, and those young at heart can join us as well. You're right with it. Oh,
there he is.
That's the young at heart.
I'm here.
Excellent. Look at all the young at heart. This is so great. I'm loving this outfit that you have on. It's very nice. All right. I have a microphone that I can hand around because I have a question. What are some things that make you angry? Oh, you're ready.
Like some things that people take away from you that you wanted.
Yeah, that
yeah,
makes
that can make you angry.
It can, for sure, right? Yeah.
I was gonna say that
one. Oh, you were faster. Anything else? Yeah.
When someone hurts you?
When someone hurts you, yeah, definitely. Anybody else? Things that make you angry? Do you have one? Too shy, that's okay. But I can understand, because I would probably agree with you. Whatever you're thinking, I will agree with you. Yeah. So what are some things from the adults that make, oh, I almost fell off my chair. Oh, that was a close one. Anything from the adults that, yeah, Sandy?
Bad drivers.
Oh my gosh. Don't even get me started, right? On the bad drivers. Yes. Anybody else? All right, so we have, oh, strummers, anything that you want to share that might get you angry?
Rudeness.
Rudeness, yes. Yeah.
When one just preserves are all sold out.
Oh my gosh, did you hear that? When Wanda's preserves are all sold out, yes. That is an angry, yeah. Yeah, it raises something in us, right? Yeah. All right, we're talking, our scripture today with that goes with the Beatles songs. Is about Jesus going into the temple and getting mad. I actually like this scripture so much because it shows Jesus's human side, right? He got frustrated because people were losing sight of what the temple was for. And so the temple was a place of prayer and reflection and, you know, getting in touch with God, all those kinds of things. And people weren't doing that. They were taking advantage of the moment. And so he got mad. And do you know the story? Okay, he got so mad that he, like, flipped over tables. Right? He didn't kill anybody, no. No. But he pushed over, yeah, that's right. Flipped over tables, and, yeah, it was very dramatic. Very dramatic. But sometimes we get so angry about things, especially things that are unjust, or things that we have little control over, that we can get really angry sometimes. And so it gives me comfort that Jesus had these feelings too, that Jesus was holy and divine, or human and divine. And so his human side got a little bit angry, and that's okay. So, but then he continued after he got that out of his system. He healed people that were blind, and he kept doing like all the wonderful things that Jesus does. And so the children, your guys' age, were there, and they thought this was awesome. And the kids were praising Jesus. What are some ways that kids can praise Jesus? Do you think?
Clap.
Clap, yeah. Bringing him presents, yeah. Oh, you didn't have your hand up? I'm sorry. I was going to say dancing. You could dance. Yeah. Sing, exactly. Take him to a special place. Yeah, yeah, all those things. Now, people that were watching Jesus, first of all, didn't appreciate that he flipped over the tables, but then didn't appreciate that he was healing people in the church or in the temple, and so, but they didn't have the guts to actually say anything to Jesus directly, and so they complained to the kids. And they said, oh, that's not appropriate. That can't happen.
Yeah.
And Jesus said, what do you think Jesus said about that?
No.
Yeah. It's like, what are you talking about? Like, this is exactly what should be happening, right? So Jesus always had kids' backs. Like, he always had support and had your back, right? For being kids and doing what all the wonderful things that you do. Yeah. So those are some of the things that we're talking about in the adults, and you guys are going to be doing something a little bit around that. Justice, all those things that make us angry, right? Those things that hurt our hearts that happen in the world that sometimes we don't have control over, right? Yeah, and how we can maybe help with those kinds of things, right? Even in a little way, right?
Yeah.
So we're going to say a prayer, a repeat after me prayer. Are we ready?
I'm ready.
Are you ready? Okay. Accepting God.
Thank you for Jesus.
Who loves everyone,
and
helps everyone.
Help us to do the same.
Amen. All right. So kids can go off to Sunday school. Youth can go off to youth group if we have youth. Young at heart can stay here. And we're going to carry on our worship service by singing Obladi Oblada. It's going to be so fun. Let's stand as we're comfortable and able. Those of you at home, please do join us in singing.
Today's scripture is from Matthew 21, verses 12 to 17 from the Inclusive Bible. When Jesus entered the temple, he drove out all those who were selling and buying there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those selling doves. He said to them, "Scripture says, My house is called a house of prayer, but you make it a den of thieves. Those who were blind or couldn't walk came to him in the temple, and he healed them. When the chief priests and teachers of the law saw the wonderful things Jesus did and heard the children shouting, "Hosanna to the heir to the house of David," throughout the temple area, they became indignant. "Do you hear what the children are shouting?" they asked him. "Yes," Jesus replied. "Have you never read, from the mouths of children and nursing babies, you have brought forth praise?" After leaving them, he went out to Bethany to spend the night. This is the witness of the church.
Thanks be to God.
So because we're doing this series with Foothills United Church, Marian is doing two of the sermons and I'm doing two of the sermons. So this is Marian's today, which was pre-recorded last week. So enjoy.
Good morning. This morning we begin our Beatles series with looking at the song, the Beatles song, Let It Be. Let It Be is one of the most famous Beatles songs and probably one of my favorites. I always found it to be soul-touching and comforting, and a comforting melody. As it turns out, that is exactly why Paul McCartney wrote the song. In the later part of the 1960s, Paul McCartney's public persona remained upbeat. But privately, he was feeling insecure and wounded by the gradual disintegration of the Beatles. During this period, the singer had a dream wherein he was visited by his deceased mother, Mary, who passed away in 1956 when John was only 14 years old. In the dream, she was assuring him, amongst the turmoil of the Beatles' slow breakup, that everything would be all right. McCartney shares, "One night during this tense time, I had a dream and saw my mom, who's been dead for 10 years or so. And it was so great to see her, because that's a wonderful thing about dreams. You actually are reunited with that person for a second. There they are, and you appear to be both physically and together again. It was so wonderful for me, and she was very reassuring. In the dream, she said, 'It'll be all right.' I'm not sure if she used the words, 'let it be,' but that was the gist of her advice. It was, 'Don't worry too much. It will turn out okay.' It was such a sweet dream, I woke up thinking, 'Oh, it was really great to visit with her again.' I felt very blessed to have that dream. So that got me writing the song, 'Let It Be.' I literally started off, 'Mother Mary,' which was her name. When I find myself in times of trouble, which I certainly found myself in, the song was based on that dream." Let It Be was released in 1970, and the rest is history. It is a great song, and it's a good reminder that sometimes we just have to let things be. Go with the flow, everything will work out all right. The sun will shine and an answer will come. Which is maybe why I like the song so much, because that's sort of been my way of doing things for quite a number of years. The phrase "whatever" comes to mind. I used those words so often when I worked on at the Colony School with my girlfriend. She even was going to buy me a pair of earrings saying "whatever," one on each side. I haven't used that word in a long time, I don't think. Probably because I've changed and evolved and with age and maturity. And because I have become more aware and informed about the world around me. I can't seem to just sit comfortably in my little bubble anymore, particularly after I've moved to Calgary. I'm not able to unsee things that I've seen and unlearn things that I've learned. So when I hear the words "let it be," I still find comfort and hope in knowing that things may work out. But as I said earlier, I can't unsee or unlearn. I can't unsee all the brokenness in our world. I can't unlearn all the ways in which we as humans are divided or disconnected. Which is why I named today's reflection, "Should We Let It Be?" A few months ago, Tracy shared that St. Thomas was going to do a sermon series on the Beatles, and she invited me to join in. I was thinking about the various Beatles songs, and of course the song "Let It Be" came to mind. After a bit of reflection and out of the clear blue, out of the field, left field, I had an epiphany. Should we let it be? It is nice to be comfortable and all and live in such a way that we are able to just let things be or know that everything will work out, hopefully for the best. Whatever happens, happens, right? However, after a little thought, I think for me anyway, that would be like sticking my head in the sand and not actually seeing what's really going on around us. Which brings us to our scripture for today. There's four accounts of the story of Jesus entering the temple and confronting the temple system. One is in Matthew 21, which we heard. The other one is in Mark 11, and the third account is in Luke 19, and the fourth in John 2. All four of these accounts, although they are written by different people, all communicate the story in a similar way. On the day that Jesus arrived at the temple, he was an adult. Remember, this was not his first time at the temple. He'd been there as a child in arms, and then again at 12 years later as a youth. But on this day, he surveys the scene through adult eyes, mature eyes, eyes that cannot unsee. He cannot allow himself to turn away or stick his head in the sand any longer. This vast courtyard that he was gazing upon was one of the meeting places of the ancient world. In those days, there were about 3 million Jews in the country and about 4 million spread across the Mediterranean world. Anyone who could possibly afford to come to the temple did so. As soon as a visitor climbed the vast steps and entered the courtyard, he had to buy something to make a sacrifice. Prices were high, and the only money that was accepted was the local currency, the shekel. Every visitor had to change money. The rates were exorbitant. The treasury of the temple was one of the ancient world's great banking houses. In this scene, Jesus is disgusted. Disgust turns to anger, and anger turns into action. Obviously, he makes quite a disturbance. Now, one must note that he is not dismissing the worship of the temple. He's not attacking the spiritual tradition that has formed his whole life and will remain in the hearts of the first generation of his own followers as long as they live in or near Jerusalem. He is attacking the perversion of this ancient and glorious tradition. He is, in essence, shouting, stop. Stop making my father's house a marketplace. Stop cheating the marginalized. Stop, stop, stop. This cannot continue to happen. And in his frustration and anger, he uses a whip and turns some tables over. How often have we felt the same way? Wanting to cause a disturbance, flip some tables when we see things that are unjust. I know I have felt like flipping tables and shouting at the top of my lungs, stop, enough already, from time to time. In fact, to be honest, when I really think about it, I usually probably say it daily. Maybe not using my outside voice, but using my inside voice in my head, but I say it nonetheless. Now, I don't know how many times, when I reflect on this story, how many times I've heard people say words similar to this. As a Christian, you shouldn't get angry. Anger is a sin. Well, let's face it, then we've all sinned. In my opinion, it's impossible to not get angry. The trick, though, is to realize that there are two different kinds of anger. Unrighteous anger, the kind of anger that is destructive and seeks to destroy or hurt another person. This type of anger is the one we seek to avoid. The second type of anger is righteous anger. Righteous anger is rooted in the desire to protect what we value and stand up for justice. It comes from a place of love and understanding. It comes from a place of compassion for the marginalized and the oppressed. And it aims to bring about positive change. It is not driven by selfishness or personal offense. Righteous anger is also aligns with God's character of love and justice. This is what Jesus demonstrated that day in the temple. Sometimes when people who haven't heard this story before are surprised that Jesus showed anger in this way, even though Jesus was very patient and taught to turn the other cheek, he also showed that there were times for righteous anger. And Jesus demonstrated this against the money changers. There are times when you are wronged, and get to turn the other cheek and say, whatever, let it be. But there are also moments when we see an injustice in the world and we can fight against it. We must fight against it. Jesus was upset with those using the temple, his father's house, to cheat and hurt other people. In today's world, just like in ancient times, we see injustices. We see human trafficking or abuse. We see increased homophobia, Islamophobia, increased intolerance in so many areas. We see increased disparity between the haves and the have-nots. We see increased hate for the other. We see increased oppression for the marginalized, and on and on and on. So much brokenness and so much needless heartache and pain. We know these things are wrong, and they go against what the Bible tells us. They go against most teachings of most religious organizations or institutions. However, most of the religious texts also give us the answers and wisdom we need to fight against these injustices. Today we can combat that which is unjust by joining organizations or other communities of faith that will fight against the very injustices that tear our communities and our world apart. We can combat injustices by shouting stop and taking action when we see someone being taken advantage of or hurt. We can stop sticking our head in the sand or turning away and pretending not to see. Jesus shows us that it is okay to get angry if it's the right kind of anger. It is okay to take action and stir things up a bit. It's okay to flip a table every so often, metaphorically speaking. So back to our Beatles song for this week, Let It Be. I still love the song, but I will forever hear the song in a different way. Should we let it be? In times of trouble and there is darkness all around, may we hear the words of wisdom and act upon it. When the brokenhearted people agree, this will be the answer. May we act upon it. When there is division and discord, may we help to bring resolution and peace. May we act upon it, for this will be the answer. When the night is cloudy for those around us, can we be the light that shines until tomorrow? May we act upon it. When we can all wake up to the sound of music in the morning, we know that wisdom has come. May we listen to the whispers of that wisdom. May it be so. Amen.
Thank you.
love doing these kinds of series with secular music because it reminds us that there are messages and that there are deep feelings that come up with any kind of music. It doesn't need to be church sacred music all the time, right? It speaks to us, music speaks to us in so many ways. So I give you great thanks for your gift of music this morning. So this is the time that we enter into a time where we recognize the gifts of God's people for the ministries of this here at St. Thomas. For the gifts to continue here at St. Thomas United Church. And so we give you great thanks for your time and your talent. And we also give thanks for your treasure. Let us move into a time of our offering. Please join with me in our prayer of thanks. Let us pray together. God of all peoples and God of all places, we present these offerings that they may be used to extend your liberating reign. With them, we offer our varied ministries that each of us may be part of your answer to the cries of the world. Amen. Please be seated. We're going to prepare our hearts for prayer by singing a portion of Yesterday.
Thank you.
God of love, we come before you with all that weighs heavy on our hearts. We gather to pray for all whose lives have been forever altered for a whole host of reasons. We pray for those who work for justice, offer medical aid, clean up committees when there is damage and destruction, and for those who feed and care for their neighbor. We pray for continued blessings on all the peacemakers, on leaders who value peace, and on everyone who promotes nonviolent solutions to conflict. We pray for all children and families, and particularly for the orphaned, neglected, abused, broken, and families of every kind, and those who live in fear of violence or disease, that they may be comforted and protected. God of fellowship and equality, we pray for an end to prejudice throughout our country and the world, that we respect all people as precious children of God. We pray for the strength of heart and mind to look beyond ourselves and address the needs of our siblings throughout the world. God of outcasts and wanderers, we pray for all immigrants, refugees, and pilgrims from around the world, that they may be welcomed in our midst and be treated with fairness, dignity, and respect. We pray that the Holy Spirit may embrace the most vulnerable members of our society, for an end to the growing disparity between the rich and poor, and for the grace and courage to strive for economic justice. God of mercy and healing, we pray for all prisoners and captives, that a spirit of forgiveness may replace vengeance and retribution, and that we, with all the destitute, lonely, and oppressed, may be restored to the fullness of your grace. We pray for the sick, the aged, and the infirm, for those with physical or mental disabilities, that all may have access to proper health care, and that God's loving embrace may be felt by all who suffer. We pray for all nations, that we may live in unity, peace, and agreement, and that all people may know justice and enjoy the perfect freedom that only you can give. We pray that we may be good stewards of creation, that we will become better caretakers of all that has been entrusted to us. God of outreach and restoration, we pray for the reconciliation of all people, and for faiths around the world, that they may be instruments of your healing love. O God, you made us in your image and redeemed us through Jesus. Take away the arrogance and hatred which infect our hearts. Break down the walls that separate us. Unite us in bonds of curiosity and love, so that in your good time, all nations and races may serve you in harmony. We bring forth now the gathered prayers of this community, both in person and online. We pray for Sandy's family following his medical assistance in dying on Wednesday. We pray for Cease and her continued recovery and hope and hopeful return on Monday. We pray for Keith and others dealing with the effects of long COVID. We pray for Nada, who's struggling with ongoing serious health concerns. We pray for the people of Israel and Gaza with increased violence now from Iran. And we pray for all those affected by the stabbing deaths in Australia. We pray for Vivio as he faces his cancer battle. Fabiana, that she continues to be strong. We pray for Nan, recovering in Foothills Hospital from an infection. We pray for adequate and rapid humanitarian aid delivery to the Palestinians. We pray for blessings and strength for families affected by the opioid crisis. We pray for a friend who lost her mother this week, prayer for a sister who lost her husband this week, and prayer for the loss of a cousin. We give praise for the beautiful upbeat music of the Prairie Mountain Fiddlers attended by some of us yesterday. We pray for Jacob. Pray that you let me ask the right questions at our son's doctor's appointment this week. We pray for Errol recovering from surgery. We pray for Marlon, Al, and Michael's healing. With great thanks for the blessing of a safe delivery of a precious grandbaby, we give thanks. We pray for brother-in-law Chris, who was in an accident yesterday, shattering part of his spine. We pray for his recovery and for his wife and two children. We give great thanks for the happiness that rises in us as we celebrate. Those marking special days this coming week include Ruth Ann, Sheila, Vicky, Louise, and an anniversary for Dick and Heather. Holy One, we know you hear all our prayers, whether they are spoken aloud or held silently in our hearts, and so we continue praying by singing together the Lord's Prayer. Amen. Let us join together in our final hymn, Revolution. We're going to sing the whole thing, aren't we? Revolution. And I want to give a special thanks to Carrie. Most of you know that she did like 2.5 hours of Beatles recordings. It's been on our YouTube channel for a few months now. And the background for all these hymns is her recording. So thank you again for that. Let us stand as we're comfortable and able. Those of you who won't, please do it. Join us.
Well, you know, we don't want to change your head. pictures of Chandler now. We're gonna make it with anyone anyhow. Don't you know it's gonna be
Maxine to come up for a quick announcement. I know you're usually at the end. I'm getting you moving right away.
Well, the good news is that I'm getting lots of wonderful volunteers, and I know everybody is saving lots of wonderful things and telling all their friends and family, right? Good.
Right.
Well, now I have to tell you, well, it's not bad news, but it's a little bit of work. When you bring things in, please bring in things that work. Check them out. Please bring in things that are clean. I don't know how many loads of laundry I've done this week on bedding, towels, and all these things. How many towels do I need? Ask yourself that. But anyway, things we can't take are big furniture, car seats, construction materials, large appliances, stereo consoles, newspapers, encyclopedias, swing sets, TVs, computer monitors, mattresses, water beds, auto parts. Everything else we're game for. Thank you for your help.
Awesome. Thank you. Coffee and conversation is happening upstairs after the service because we have a market going on. Community markets have it happening upstairs as well. There is an elevator for those of you that need the elevator. Next Sunday, Creation Care is doing a lunch and learn right after the service. The City of Calgary is coming in to teach us what exactly goes into every single bin, because it can be complicated. So they're doing a lunch and learn on that. And then later on next Sunday at 2 o'clock, we're screening a documentary called 1946, The Mistranslation That Shifted Culture. What if the word homosexual was never supposed to be part of the Bible? It's a great documentary. So come for that. In the bulletin, there is a link. You actually have to go to the link to purchase tickets. The tickets are $10 each, and that's to help pay for the licensing fee that we had to pay for the special licensing fee to show the video. Please consider coming. We'd like to have at least 20 people here, so that we can cover the licensing costs. So consider coming, bring your friends along, we'll have a little panel discussion afterwards, and so looking forward to that. So any other announcements that I've missed?
Yes.
Oh.
Go, 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 Joseph.
Isn't this the dreamiest of dream coats
it
ever?
It is the dreamiest.
Yes. It's from Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat. And Joseph can interpret dreams.
What?
So tell me of your dreams, my friend, and I will tell you what they show. Although I cannot guarantee to get it right, I'll have a go. But I'm not going to bother you for your dreams. I think we have similar dreams. In fact, we envision that on April 27th, this room will be filled with music from all the choirs, all the orchestra, and the strummers. And of course, all this I envision to be full of people from Calgary, maybe from the world beyond. But, so, buying your tickets is what we need to fill all these seats and get that dream happening. So, where is she? There she is. Okay, Sandy will be out. Don't spend all your money at the market. She'll be out with tickets.
Upstairs. In the market.
She'll be upstairs at the market with the tickets. So thank you. Tracy, I have to run. It was only a short announcement.
Okay.
A couple of politicians asked me to interpret their dreams.
Yeah.
And they can be real dreamers, as you know. So
yes. Yes, buy your tickets. That's right, exactly. There are two showings, 2 o'clock and 7. So have a great week, everyone. I hope to see most of you upstairs, and we'll chat then a little bit more. Take care.
She's not a girl who misses my with the touch of the velvet hand, like a lizard on a window pane. The man in the crowd with the multicolored mirrors on his hobnail boots, lying with his eyes while his hands are busy working overtime. A soap impression of his wife, which he ate and donated to the National Trust.